Coming up on today's vlog, just what you've always wanted, the physics of inline five-cylinder engines. Yes! Maximum Engine Nerd Month continues, obviously. And I blame chicks for this because if they just threw themselves routinely at the guys with the big brains, the human race would be in a far better place today. And you know they want to. As things stand, though, this report could well be the miracle cure for insomnia for some of you. Yes. But engineering porn for others, guaranteed. And I know that it will not get you laid. At least, not with a woman. I'm John Cadogan from autoexpert.com.au, the place where Aussie new car buyers save thousands off their next new cars. Hit me up on the website for that. Interesting comment coming up from one of you about yesterday's vlog too, and automotive advertising in general. Stay tuned for that. And a quick shout out to Michael Clarkson, a loyal viewer of the show. He's a big fan of the Denver Broncos, mighty Super Bowl champions, 1997, 98 and 2015. Yes. Not too keen on seeing me in a Raiders hat though, I note. Thanks for the Broncos hats, Michael. Apparently, this is a deep-rooted, retardistani cultural thing. Mini horse's head on a hat. It's kind of like a deleted scene from The Godfather. What would you rather wake up to in bed? 100 duck-sized horse heads or one giant horse-sized duck head? Anyway, greetings from the newest Broncos fan in the world. And a quick shout out to all you fine, upstanding auto expert viewers in the mile-high city of Denver. How do you breathe up there? I mean, Shittsville is pretty flat. And we only have six mountains that pimples, really. Little more than that, anyway. At 1 mile above sea level or higher, it's pathetic. Most of we Australians typically get a nosebleed from climbing out of the ocean and into our fine shaggin' wagons after stabbing a white pointer with a Mick Dundee Bowie knife. That's how we do it down here. I guess everyone needs a hobby. Today's report is an extension of last week's deep dive into inline fours, straight sixes and V6s and bent eights. There's a link somewhere up there. Just follow the little Bronco's head into the corner if you're watching on a desktop. An outpouring of grief, actually, from some of you followed that report to the effect of how dare I neglect inline fives and treat boxes as if they just don't matter. I was accused of being the engine equivalent of a racist, a macylindrist, or whatever you call that particular bias. So I guess this is an apology of sorts. Fives today, the inline kind, and boxes tomorrow, the horizontally opposed ones, you've been warned. Inline fives, you'll find them in service today on the Ford Ranger and Mazda BT50, the tomato of diesel utes. That's a pickup truck if you're watching in retardistan. Various manufacturers, including Merc, Audi, Ford, Volvo, Jeep, etc., have had their dalliance with inline fives in both petrol and diesel. But the reason inline five-cylinder petrol engines are late bloomers on our fine automotive landscape is carburettors. They suck. If you try to fuel an inline five with a single carburettor, you run into unavoidably inconsistent fueling problems between the cylinders. It's just not symmetrical. If you fit multiple carbs, say two or three, one of those carbs always fuels more or fewer cylinders, making it inherently difficult, bordering on impossible, or at the very least, practically unworkable to balance up the fueling on every cylinder. Hypothetically, I suppose you could fit five carburettors and solve this problem, one for each port, but that's not really a viable suggestion if you want to save cost over producing a comparable six-cylinder engine. Multi-point fuel injection is what solved that problem and made five-cylinder petrol engines viable, because one central fuel pump feeds five injectors, one in each inlet port, making even fueling easy to achieve. Direct injection, which came later, delivers even better injection control. So that's nice. This also explains why five-cylinder diesels were more historically popular decades earlier, because all diesels are compression ignition fuel injected engines, obviously. The other thing about five cylinders is that in a four-stroke engine, one complete cycle is two revs, right? Suck, squeeze, bang, and blow in two revs. 720 degrees of crank rotation. 720 degrees divided by five cylinders is 144 degrees between firing strokes. And 360 degrees divided by 144 doesn't give you a whole number. So a five-cylinder engine cannot share crank phases, unlike a six-cylinder or an eight-cylinder engine. If you don't get what that means, four crank throws at 90 degrees can serve a V8, and three crank throws phased at 120 degrees can serve a six, and you will still get even firing pulses, which you really do want to achieve in an engine. Inline fives need five separate crank pins at 72 degrees to deliver even firing pulses. And the main advantage of an inline five over a four is that the firing pulses are a lot closer together. In a four, the firing pulses are 180 degrees apart. Four times 180 equals 720 degrees, just enough rotation for each cylinder to fire once, right? Two complete revs. And that means one firing pulse finishes about 60 degrees of crank rotation before the next one begins in a four. Firing pulses last about 120 degrees of crank rotation. So that 60-degree gap in a four-cylinder engine causes rotational pulses of the crank, kind of like being hit with a rattle gun every time a cylinder fires, only kind of a lot faster. In a five-cylinder engine, that's far less pronounced because the pulses are only about 24 degrees apart, not 60. So they're a lot smoother in that sense. That's 120 degrees worth of pulse, right? That is a ballpark estimate based on road engine fundamentals, and it kind of defines the end of the power stroke as the point at which the exhaust valve opens. It's a rule of thumb, basically. There's a few inherent balance deficits in inline fives. They have planar imbalance on the reciprocating mass and on the rotating mass, and also on compression. So you need nice heavy counterweights to mask all that, and this results in an engine that doesn't rev up all that fast. But they're sort of okay for secondary balance, depending on which firing order you use. Almost comparable to an inline six in that respect, in the best case for firing sequence. And that means you can design them a bit under square with a relatively long stroke relative to the bore without compromising high RPM smoothness. And this matters because high revs tend to highlight poor secondary imbalance problems in engines, which is a euphemistic way of saying the engine shakes like all power of shit at high revs if it's susceptible to those secondary out of balance effects. Inline fours are pretty bad at that. With an undersquare 5, the small bore long stroke design means that you can reduce the overall length of the engine if you're a designer, and you can put them in an engine bay that's about the same size as you'd need for a 4-cylinder, provided the bean counters will wear the additional cost of all of those extra parts, the extra machining, and, of course, screwing them all together. Another way of looking at this, perhaps, is you can have a 3-point-something inline 5 for a lot less cost and less physical space than an inline 6, or slightly more space but still less cost than a V6. It'll be slightly rougher, but hey, you know, we're saving the big bucks here. You can justify that. Volkswagen uses a 3-litre inline 6 in the Amarok, and Ford uses a 3.2-litre inline 5 in the Ranger. You can say that the Amarok is more powerful, and it certainly is, but it's spinning 50% faster and only making 12% more power. So the torque production is actually falling in a hole at high revs. Power equals torque times revs, right? Do you really want to rev a diesel like the Amarok to 4,500 revs for maximum acceleration at any particular road speed, or would you rather be at 3,000 revs like in the Ford Mazda engine? I'll take 3,000, thanks very much. If you want to be the full nerd on inline five, well, here is the pub conversation stopper. There are 24 different potential firing order permutations that support a 144 degree phasing of the crank for a four stroke. But they only commonly use two of those permutations in production. 1-2-4-5-3 is the combination that minimizes the crank speed rocking couple vibration, and it's the most common firing order for inline fives on road cars. But 1-5-2-3-4 minimizes secondary imbalance, and that's the one they use commonly in V10s, which are essentially two inline fives Siamese together and sharing a crank. The Audi R8, the BMW E60 and E61 M5s, and the E63 and E64 M6s use that second firing order. I think the Dodge Viper did as well. The 1-5-2-3-4 order in the V10s has a high primary rocking couple, and it's not such a good choice for inline fives, but it suits the V10s because it allows higher revs. You know, statistically, nobody knows that about the firing orders, and now you do. Boxer engines coming up tomorrow. I've detained you long enough on inline fives, that's for sure. But before we go, let's deconstruct car advertising in general and that crap Audi Super Bowl ad in particular. Am I the only one that wishes car ads were about the fucking cars, not bullshit branding and airy-fairy crap like that? No matter what your views on feminism or equal pay, what does that have to do with whether it's a good idea to buy a shitty Audi? This comment earlier today from Alonzo Hawk really strikes a nerve with me. These airy-fairy meaningless ads, you know, they just don't help. Dancing mops? Finding a friggin' biscuit?
Why do the good ones always run out first? It's like the Ford best ever run out.
Aspiring to be some kind of goat? Quiet breathtakingness. Hashtag FFS.
Just equal parts quiet and breathtaking.
And, perhaps most nauseatingly, Children Transformers, Optimus Mini Prime in a yellow monkey spanker banana suit. None of this could ever motivate me to buy any particular car. Is it any wonder, therefore, that the most common complaint I get from non-car aficionados about actually selecting a new car is utter confusion? They're stalled on the grid. The marketing messages are simply not helpful, and half the time, the ad agency just wants to use the client's money to win some industry award. They're not often all that concerned with actually selling the product, incredibly enough. So I think, while you're onto something there, Alonzo, it's probably not going to catch on. Truth in advertising. And interestingly, nobody picked up on this. Nobody has yet identified the most basic errors in that shameful Audi boxcar feminazi daughter ad for the Super Bowl, featured in yesterday's vlog. Despite the megabucks, the big production values, you know, they probably shot it in a friggin' 8K on a red weapon helium. Those dipshits could not even get the basic continuity and cinematography right. Here it is.
What do I tell my daughter? Do I tell her that her grandpa's worth more than her grandma?
So, dad's at the start line, right? Virtue signalling about the sexist nature of society via his own inner dialogue, when he should just be cheering for his friggin' daughter and hoping that she doesn't break her neck.
That her dad is worth more than her mom.
There is, of course, a significant downhill race for several minutes.
Do I tell her that despite her education, her drive, her skills, her intelligence, she will automatically be valued as less than every man she ever meets.
Go, power! Stoicism! The daughter wins fair and square! Yes!
Or maybe I'll be able to tell her something different.
So how in all the blazes that are blue did he get to the other end of the track? He's taking her friggin' helmet off at the other end of the race. New S5 shit heap, now with wormhole tronic plus. Or maybe they just fucked up. And they keep reversing the damn screen direction of the action and crossing the line, thus breaking two of the most essential cinematography rules of all time. That's why the ad is so hard to watch, at least in terms of following the action. They break the most basic rules of shooting a fundamental action sequence, but I guess they only do it half a dozen times. There's actually an established language for the portrayal of action in cinema, and this advertisement simply does not give you that. But look at any action film. Action sequences from sword fights to car chases, they simply don't work like that. And you can, of course, break these rules, but only if you do it for a reason. And this advertisement just doesn't offer you one of those. A first-year film school student would be failed for shooting that. And almost any film student could do a better job directing it. And nobody at Audi America in the marketing department, shamefully enough, apparently has the basic knowledge of the use of the medium to veto this ridiculous execution. Far too much wank and not nearly enough focus on the basics, I'd suggest. They spent millions producing and playing a cinematic abomination. Those ponytailed, designer water-sipping, skinny jeans-wearing, death metal-tattooed, worthless creative bags of dick tips at advertising agencies. They have rather a lot to answer for, if you ask me. It's just the tip of the incompetence iceberg right there. Let me know what you think in the comments feed below. I'm John Cadogan and I will be in my boxes tomorrow. And so will you. We will suck, we will squeeze, we will bang, and we will almost certainly blow together in horizontal opposition. As Bill Cosby said so famously, so many times, there's something to look forward to in the long night ahead. Thanks for watching.